I'm Bridget Green.
And I'm Cavin Weber.
And today we're talking about robotics. So good to have you here, finally.
I heard you want to talk about technology. You don't have to twist my arm too hard on that topic.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Are you looking for secrets?
Bring up.
Bridget. She's dead. You may not like it, but this is what peak performance looks like.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to The Bring Up. Hey, Cavin, do you know that AMD does robots now?
Yeah, I don't know that does robots is like the super technical term our engineers would use, but yeah, we do robots. There's some really interesting AMD products, actually. They're made specifically for building out whole robotics systems, and they're just too cool not to share with you guys.
Obviously, robots are playing an increasingly large role in all of our lives, like in surgical robots, delivery robots, and most importantly, the robot at the revolving sushi place that I like that sings a little song when it brings out the sushi.
Very important.
And before we go into the AMD products that are advancing some of these systems, why don't we break down robots just a little bit?
Sure.
So robots are inherently a system of systems, you could say.
Yeah, like a dream within a dream.
Yes. Where heterogeneous compute clusters work together. And so you could say that robotics is the art of system integration.
And a notoriously really difficult art form, that is. You've made all these cool little individual pieces that work really well on their own. You've got your vision control systems and your motor control systems, and then you try to put them together again, and suddenly nothing works at all. That's why the brilliant engineers at AMD developed the Kria SOM family, which is a series of system-on-module devices that each act as their own little expert at a specific task, like a camera system, for example.
Yeah, and another thing that wanted to highlight of... Hey, Cavin, what is the big red thing for?
Let's just say I built a robot of my own using one of the SOMs, the KR260. That's just helping me out on set a little bit. But I know you have a package to throw to, so we can talk about that afterward.
Okay, then Cavin's right. I do have a package to throw to. So these Kria systems aren't the only thing that we wanted to highlight in this episode. There's a whole host of AMD-powered robo products out there, or robotics. That one's for free. And I got a chance to see some in action in the form of 600 robots, all being controlled by teen geniuses.
Or geniuses. That one's not for free. I'm sending you an invoice.
As you should.
We're here at the FIRST Championship Robotics Competition. It's incredible, it is chaotic, and we're gonna go check it out, but safety first, guys.
For you.
Nick, what is going on here?
So this is the championships for our FIRST Robotics Competition. We've got 616 teams here from not only around the country, but around the world.
How many high schoolers would you estimate are in the building currently?
Oh, I think we're expecting to see upwards of 50,000 students total. We've got about 3,300 teams that compete every year worldwide.
What is FIRST Robotics?
Our high school program is FIRST Robotics Competition. They build a 150-pound robot, and they have to start from scratch and build a robot in about 6 to 8 weeks before the competition starts. This year's theme for FIRST is all about energy. It is bringing energy from substations to your community. And we represent that energy with two different game pieces. So the teams bring those from one end of the field, playing field, to the other end, put them in a certain arrangement to earn more points. And so they're bringing energy into their community.
I understand that all the teams get the same base hardware to start from, is that right?
It is. So every team starts with is a Robo Rio that has AMD Zynq technology built into it. That's the brain of the robot and is what's doing, you know, all of that command and control for all the robots that are out here competing.
We're Team 1511, Rolling Thunder. We are from Penfield, New York. Usually we have anywhere between 40 to 55 students in any given year.
You guys are like a little company. When you get the prompt, what happens next for you guys?
Right when we get the game, for the next like 12 hours, we are in our school until probably like midnight. We are just brainstorming. We test materials and how does the material of the actual game pieces affect what mechanism we're gonna have to build.
Now here comes the fun part, guys.
1511 is a really special team because of the way that it really focuses a little less on the robot and more on the process of learning.
That's stuff that you can use in any engineering field. Doesn't matter if you're an electrical, you're a mechanical, you're a chemistry, you can use all of those, that type of stuff.
Every single one of the kids here has a passion for STEM and has a passion for changing the world.
Thanks, Bridget. While Team 1511's Thunderbolt is very impressive, what's actually even more impressive is their advocacy work for STEAM education. They actually worked with officials to create an annual STEAM Day for the state of New York. So it's just a bunch of normal high school stuff.
Yeah, I was really bummed I didn't get to join you in the competition, but said I had to be on my stupid, boring honeymoon in Spain.
Yeah, I did feel super bad for you, which is why I suggested that you do your own robot project so that you didn't feel left out.
And I took that opportunity to solve the number one problem plaguing our show that gets called out in all the comments of nearly every episode. You see, a common complaint of our viewers is that I seem bored or sad or disinterested, but that's just not true. I, like all humans, experience the full range of emotions, from happiness to the rest of them, but the part of my brain that makes my face express those emotions just doesn't work. So I decided to think like an engineer and solve the problem with robotics.
And how, pray tell, did you do that? You know, actually, that's probably going to take you a long time to say, so I'm just going to mosey on out of this scene with one of our little wipe transitions.
Well, this isn't the first time I've done a big, weird project. I do this kind of stuff all the time. The first step is always to do some research. What I'm looking to do is formally known as facial expression classification, which is a big fancy term that means a program that can look at a person's face and tell you how it's feeling. If you Google this, you'll quickly find a couple corpuses or data sets of labeled images of human faces depicting their expression. Great, that's step one already done. Further digging showed that there's even pre-trained models that already do exactly this job. Even better, I'm basically already finished. Third, I had this cool robotics control board from AMD, the Kria KR260 Robotics Starter Kit. I've got all the parts, so putting them together should take, what, a few hours? And a few hours is all it took indeed for me to realize that I had absolutely no idea what I was doing. But what I lack in skill, I make up for in the ability to IM some of the most brilliant engineers in the world. So I got to work, and that's where AMD Pink comes in.
So Pink is an open source project from AMD that runs directly on our adaptive SoC platforms. So about 5 years ago, you were seeing explosion in machine learning. Sometimes today we forget that there's an explosion in data science as well. And it's been so complex, we in the research labs were looking at that and saying, is there anything we can take from big trends in software to try and put a cap on the complexity?
And it was extremely simple. I booted up the machine after flashing the SD card, and immediately I was able to run complex machine learning demos with the click of a button. No complicated command line interfaces, just a pretty GUI from a website on my cozy desktop.
What was the process like from recognizing that there was a problem to coming up with a solution like Pink?
When you look at all these domains, you see like, oh, how are the hardware guys gonna talk to the software guys, right? How are those two communities gonna reach out to each other? You say, let's give them a language, a framework where hardware looks like software, software can talk to hardware like it's software. In the machine learning side, we saw a lot of frameworks that were clearly, you know, in Python, right? A nice open source, new, fun to use language. We saw web-based browser IDEs, in particular Jupyter. And Jupyter is a web-based front end that allows you to write live code with markdown and documentation around it, right? And we've had a lot of people who do the quantum computing control and readout, they picked up Pink. Why? Because they're physicists and they have other things to think about than trying to work with embedded platforms, right? So they try and find the things that work for them.
What makes robotics an interesting platform for AMD to tackle, or problem for AMD to tackle? And what is AMD doing to make that problem easier to solve?
In today's trend, we're all about AI, right, and machine learning, and we think typically about large language models. But the reality is machine learning and robotics go hand in hand. right? So if you think about what robotics is, it's sensing the environment, learning something about it, right? Maybe I'm about to run into the wall, and then making a decision. So it's a feedback loop of sensing the environment and then reacting with the right action. So AMD seems to have all the parts for this, right? We have the low latency I/O with the Xilinx acquisition. And for a lot of the machine learning, you know, AMD is really stepping up and building a lot of silicon and software to handle some of those applications where you may want to learn about your environment as you're navigating it as a robot.
And this dedication isn't just some corporate tagline. I got to see it firsthand. I came to the Kria team with my weird problem, and the level of support and excitement they showed for my gag idea for the show was both startling and delightful. They went so wild that they had one of our machine learning partners, Macarena Labs, develop a custom machine learning algorithm that runs on this DPU specifically for facial expression classification. And if you get yourself an AMD Kria KR260 or KV260, which is the vision learning platform, you can try out this demo yourself. And because of the highly customizable nature of Jupyter Notebooks, you can customize it or integrate it into your own project however you please. Thanks, Cavin. Bridget, I'm really glad to have you back.
Thank you. I'm glad to be back, and I am ready to be impressed.
Well, thanks to AMD's Industrial Vision Healthcare and Sciences team, as well as the wonderful Macarena Labs, we now have a facial expression classification model. And as you can see, this demo takes my face, runs it through this classification model, and tells me how I appear to be feeling, which for someone with no means of knowing that otherwise, really feels like a superpower. Thanks, technology.
That's actually pretty cool, Cavin. I think, hot take, robotics? Pretty cool. And we hope you feel the same. Thank you very much for watching this episode.
And as always, please be sure to like and subscribe and design a robot to hit that bell icon so you never miss a future episode.
Good idea. For those of you who stuck around to the end, we have a little special treat for you, and we'll see you next time.
Okay, I just looked it up. If we leave now, we can get home in time for the robotics competition. I'm gonna buy these flights.